Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Praise be to Allah for His bounties upon us, and thanks be to Him for all that He inspired. And commended is His name for all the bounties He created before our own creation, for all the bounties that He bestowed upon us from Himself without our asking for it, and abundant and complete bounties, such plenteous and unlimited bounties whose numbers cannot be enumerated. Thanks cannot be offered for their duration and commencement, and whose perpetuity is beyond comprehension. He invited His servants to offer praise, thus resulting in increase and perpetuity in their blessings. And in lieu of this abundance of bounties, Allah desired that His creatures praise Him. Again, He invited you to perform good deeds resulting in bounties of this world and as well as for the hereafter. I bear witness that there is no other deity worthy of worship except Allah. He is unique and unparalleled. Certainly, the interpretation and result of this witness of monotheism is sincerity, and its comprehension has been placed in the hearts, and the mind is illuminated by its profound understanding. He, Allah, cannot be seen with the eyes, nor can He be described with the tongues, and His state cannot be perceived. He is the one who created all things without any archetype, and originated them without having any past image and equals. Rather, He created them with His might and dispersed them according to His will. He did not create them for a need, nor did He shape them for a benefit for Himself. But rather, He did all of this to establish His wisdom and to bring His creatures' attention to His obedience and manifest His might, so that His creatures may venerate Him. And He strengthened His invitation by dispatching His prophets and friends. Thus, He provided recompense for His obedience and granted punishment for His disobedience. He informed His slaves against performing such acts that invite His wrath, and thus would gather them in His paradise. And I bear witness that my father Muhammad is His slave and His messenger. Allah the Almighty chose him and selected him before bestowing prophethood upon him, and named him before selecting him, and chose him before sending him for the mission of Islam, when the whole of creation was concealed in the hidden world, and they were in awe in the extinction of nothingness. Almighty Allah was certainly aware of the consequences of all the tasks, and He was acquainted with the occurrences of the ages, and conscious of the position of the destined. Allah sent His Prophet so as to complete His commands, to execute His rulings, and to deliver His decisive ordinances. He saw the nation divided into various religions, addicted to their places of worship, worshipping their idols, denying Allah despite their knowledge of Him. Then Allah illuminated their darkness through the medium of my father Muhammad, peace be upon him, and lifted the veils of obscurity from their hearts, and removed ignorance from their eyes. He stood up among them for their guidance, delivered them from misguidance, enlightened their eyes from blindness, guided them towards the straight path, and invited them towards the right path. Then Allah took away his soul with affection, and with his choice, willingness and submission. Thus, Muhammad was relieved of the toils of this world and entered the world of comfort. There, he lives in ease among the righteous angels, and in the paradise of the forgiving Lord, and in the neighborhood of the mighty King. May Allah's mercy be upon my father, his messenger, and the trustworthy one concerning his revelation, his friend, the best among his creations, his favorite one, and peace upon him and Allah's mercy and blessings. You are the slaves of Allah, and you are the establishers of His commands and prohibitions. You are the possessors of his religion and his revelation, the trustworthy ones concerning yourselves, and you should propagate Islam to other nations. Do you deem yourselves worthy of all this? A pledge had been taken from you in advance by Allah, and there is among you his remembrance, and that is the book of Allah, the Quran, the speaking one. It is a book of complete truthfulness and a bright light, the brilliant light. Its eminence is evident, its secrets are revealed, its apparent aspects are clear, its adherents are envied, it leads its adherents to Jannah, to the pleasure of Allah. Its listeners are guided towards salvation, and through it are gained the illuminated evidences of Allah. It determines the ordinances and prohibitions of Allah. Its evidences are illuminated, and its proofs are sufficient. It contains the virtues of the recommended acts, freedom with regards to performing the lawful acts, and informs about the discouraged acts, and in it are written down the laws of Islam. Faith has been ordained so as to cleanse you of polytheism. Salat is prescribed to keep you away from pride. Zakat has been prescribed to purify oneself and results in the increase of sustenance. Saum has been prescribed so that sincerity may be reinforced. Hajj has been prescribed to establish religion. Justice is prescribed to establish harmony in the hearts. The obligation to obey the Ahlulbait has been prescribed to set up order in the community. And our authority, Imama, has been prescribed to save the people from differences. Jihad is the honor of Islam and a humiliation for the people of polytheism and hypocrisy. Patience has been made a means for recompense to be bestowed. Enjoining good has been prescribed for the general welfare of society. Righteousness with one's parents is a safeguard against Allah's wrath. Kindness with one's relatives is a means of increasing one's age and results in increase in friends and relations. Retribution has been prescribed so that people's lives may be safeguarded. Fulfillment of vows leads to forgiveness. Accuracy in measuring and weighing goods saves one from loss. Prohibition of intoxicants has been prescribed so that humanity may remain away from filth. The prohibition of adultery has been prescribed so as to keep oneself away from the curse of Allah. Robbery has been prohibited so that the hands may be pure, and polytheism has been prohibited so that sincerity may be established in Allah's divinity. Thus, fear Allah as you should, and see that you die not but as Muslims. Obey Allah's orders and prohibitions, for surely only those of His servants are conscious of Allah who are endowed with knowledge. O people, know that I am Fatima and my father was Muhammad. I say and I will repeat this again and again, and I do not utter any falsehood, and whatever I do cannot be wrong. Indeed, an apostle from among yourselves has come to you. Grievous to him is your falling into distress. He is concerned about your welfare, and towards the faithful he is compassionate and merciful. If you look and understand, you will find that this apostle is my father, and not the father of any of your women. He is the brother of my cousin Imam Ali, and not the brother of any of your men. And how fortunate is the one related to him. The Prophet proclaimed the message and prevented the people from ignorance and polytheism. And he opposed the customs of the polytheists. He broke their backs while their breath was entrapped in their chests. He called to the way of his Lord with wisdom and kind exhortation. He broke the idols and crushed the heads of rebellion of the polytheists until they were eradicated and took flight. Then the darkness of the night passed and it dawned, and the truth became manifest in its true form. When the leader of the religion, the Prophet, spoke, foam gushed forth from the mouths of the polytheists and they became silent. The degraded group of the hypocrites was annihilated, and pledges between disbelief and animosity broke. You all started uttering words of sincerity, and you were among a group of people with illuminated faces and fasting ones, those whom Allah intended to keep away from them uncleanliness and purify them with a thorough purification. Indeed, you were on the brink of the pit of the hellfire. You were a community that was considered just, a medium who would quench the thirst of others, but you were a tool in the hands of the avaricious. You were similar to the state where hasty men come to take the fire and were being trampled under the feet, while at that time your state was such that you would drink water from the wayside gutter, and your food was the unclean hides of animals and leaves. You were the humiliated and degraded ones from among the masses, fearing that people may carry you away by force. Thus Allah, the Blessed, the Sublime, delivered you through my father Muhammad. You attained this deliverance after he had to face numerous difficulties and fight with the stubborn polytheists, the beasts among the Arabs, and with the people of the book, the Christians and the Jews. Whenever the polytheists kindled the fires of war, Allah would put it out. And when the adherents of Satan would manifest themselves, or the beastly ones among the polytheists opened their envious mouths, the Prophet would dispatch his brother, Imam Ali, towards them. He, Imam Ali, would crush them and extinguish the blaze of their fire with his sword. And he suffered extreme brutality in the way of Allah and strove to obey the commands of Allah. He was the nearest to the Prophet of Allah and the master of the friends of Allah. He was always ready to serve the creations of Allah, looking over the welfare of the people, endeavoring and toiling in this way. He was not affected with the censure of any censurer. While you were living a life of pleasure and peace, and were far away from the severity of battle, in enjoyment and security, then you waited that we, the Ahlulbait, may be engulfed in severity of trials, and waited to hear this news. And in the heat of the battle, you retreated and fled from the battlefield. Thus, when Allah the Almighty exalted his Prophet from this perishable world towards the abode of his prophets and his chosen ones, the thorns of hypocrisy became manifest in you, and the mantle of your religion gave way, and the astray ones who were silent until yesterday suddenly started shrieking. The degraded and mean ones came forth from their burrows to the open ground, and the valiant ones of the polytheists of falsehood started roaring. Now, these very people have taken the reins of authority in their hands, and Satan has raised his head from the place of his concealment, inviting you towards evil. Thus, he found you to be among those accepting his invitation, and you held him in esteem with the intention of securing position. You were being deceived. Satan invited you to rebel and found you to be among the base and meanest of people, and he incited your rage, and thus you became enraged. Then you started to snatch the rights of others and enter the spring that did not belong to you, and you did all of this when not much time had passed since the passing of the Prophet, and the wound of his death was deep, and our hearts had not yet healed, and the corpse of the Prophet was not even laid to rest in the grave. You acted very swiftly, dreading the outbreak of an agitation. Beware that they themselves have fallen into the pit of agitation. Surely into trial have they already fallen. And verily hell encompasses the infidels. Far be it away from you. What has happened to you? Where are you wandering while the Book of Allah, the Quran, is amongst you, whose orders are apparent and judgments are illuminated, its emblems dazzling, and whose enjoyments and prohibitions are straightforward? Did you leave it behind your backs and then turn your faces away from it in disgust and turn to something else for judgment? Evil for the unjust will be the exchange, and whoever seeks a religion other than Islam, it will never be accepted from him, and in the next world he will be among the losers. You did not even wait that the tempest may calm down. Rather, you hastened to take the reins of the caliphate into your hands after having acquired it. You started to ignite the fire of mutiny, and you became engrossed in inciting the fire. You responded to the call of Satan, the seducer, And you intended to put out the light of the glorious religion. You started to destroy the practices of the chosen prophet. Then you delighted in suckling the delicacies of caliphate and opposed the Ahlulbait in secret and in open. We have no choice but to bear the cuts of your daggers and the piercing of your spears into the body. Now you presume that we do not have any inheritance from the Prophet. Do you follow the customs of the age of ignorance? Is it the judgment of the days of ignorance that you desire? Who else can be better than Allah to judge for the people of assured faith? Indeed, it is as bright as the sun that I am the daughter of the Prophet of Allah. O Muslims, is it befitting that I am deprived of my inheritance? O son of Abu Quhafa, is it contained in the glorious Quran that one should inherit from their father, while in your opinion, I should not inherit from my father? Indeed, you have attributed an unusual thing upon Allah and His Prophet. Did you intentionally forsake the Book of Allah and leave it behind your backs? Allah says, and Suleiman inherited from Dawood. Allah says concerning the life of Zakaria, so grant me from yourself an heir who shall inherit from me and inherit from the family of Yaqub. Allah says, and the blood relations are nearer to each other in the Book of Allah. Allah says, Allah enjoins upon you about your children. The male shall have the equal of the shares of two females. And He also says, if he, the believer, leaves behind any goods, he should make a bequest for parents and the nearest kinsmen in goodness. This is a duty upon the pious ones. You assume that I do not have a share in inheritance, and that I should not inherit from my father, and that there is no relation between us. Has Allah in His verses of the Quran not taken into consideration everyone in general? And are not all of the classes of men included in these verses? Is my father discharged from the application of this verse? Or do you say that two people of the same community do not inherit from one another? Are my father and I not part of one community? Then, are you more cognizant of understanding the general and particular verses of the Quran than my father and my cousin Ali? Then take it, Fadak, until we meet you on the Day of Judgment, where Allah will be the best judge, and Muhammad will be the claimant on that day, and our destined time of meeting will be the resurrection. And on that promised day, the fallacious ones will be engulfed in deep loss, and their regret on that day will be of no use to them. For every prophecy, there is a prefix time, and you will soon realize upon whom a torment of tribulations will descend, which will disgrace him, and on who falls this lasting punishment. O group of valorous men, the aides of the nation, the helpers of Islam, what is this slackness that you display towards me? You are witnessing the oppression being meted out upon me, but you still lie in a deep sleep. Did my father not say that the rights of a father for his children must be considered? How soon have you changed tracks? Even though you possess the strength to stand up for my rights and are capable of supporting my claim, do you now say that Muhammad has passed away and there remains no responsibility upon us? His loss is great, and the chasm that has appeared in Islam is severe, and the division is immense. Unity has been shattered. The earth is engulfed in darkness due to his concealment. The sun and the moon are eclipsed, and the stars have scattered away. Hopes have broken. Mountains have crumbled. The family of the Prophet has been lost, and their sanctity has been dishonored after his death. This is, by Allah, a great calamity and a grand adversity. While this calamity is incomparable, and there is no other greater calamity than the death of the Prophet. The death of the Prophet had already been conveyed to you in the Book of Allah. May He be glorified. You were reading the Quran day and night in a loud voice, lamentingly, in a normal tone and in a pleasant voice. As for what happened in the past to Allah's prophets and apostles, the command is decisive and destiny enjoined. And Muhammad is not but an apostle. Other apostles have already passed away prior to him. Therefore, if he dies or is killed, will you turn upon your heels and And he who turns upon his heels will by no means do harm to Allah in the least. And soon shall we reward the grateful ones. Be aware, I have said what I wanted to say, even though I know that you will not assist me, as this slackness of yours to assist us has become a part of your heart, your practice. But all of this complaint is the result of the grief in my heart and the internal rage that I feel, and I know that it is of no use. But I have said this to manifest my internal sorrow and to complete my proof upon you. Thus, usurp Fadak and fasten it firmly, for it is weak and feeble, while its shame and disgrace will always remain over you. The sign of the rage of the Supreme Allah has been cast upon it, and it will be an everlasting disgrace upon you, and it will lead you to the fire of Allah, which will engulf the heart. Thus, Allah sees whatever you do, and soon shall those who deal unjustly know what an evil turning they will be turned into. I am the daughter of that Prophet who was sent to warn you against the severe wrath of Allah. So, act, and so will we, and wait, and we shall wait.